Okay, we'll get started. Thank you, everybody, for coming to NVIDIA. So if everybody could silence their cell phones, me included, because mine will ring, guaranteed. Let's all do it together. Welcome to NVIDIA. My name is Scott Walker. I'm responsible for global investigations, or managing global investigations for NVIDIA. And I'm a friend of Kim and a friend of ASIS International, the local chapter here. We had a conversation a couple months ago about putting together a little luncheon. It's not little. You all are great for showing up and coming and talking about these very, very important things that we're going to talk about today. We've got an amazing panel for you. I want lots and lots of questions. Just barrage them with questions, because this is something that's very important to everybody in this room, and we want to make a change for the future. And for people like my daughter, one of the women heroes in my life, she's 19, going to be 20 in July, if you can believe it. And she told me just the other night, "Hey, Dad, I'm thinking about taking some investigation classes in college." And I said, "Run." No, just kidding. I'm very, very happy for her. She's a psych major, so if anybody you know in psychology, you know what that costs and how important it is to have somebody like that in your life. But my first hero, I like to tell a quick story. My first hero, you may know, I was born from a female. My mom, amazing lady, 5'2", at 50-plus years old, she thought, "I'm going to go be a flight attendant." And so she became a flight attendant for Northwest Airlines before September 11th. And all growing up throughout her whole life, she couldn't stand that I was in the military. I retired from the Air Force as a special agent, and she couldn't stand that I was around guns. She really didn't like those things. And as I was going through a law enforcement academy, she would call me. She was going through the flight attendant academy, and she'd call me. And I don't like bombs on planes and guns on planes and things like that. And I'd say, "Yeah, Mom, I understand, but you know, there's a lot of security around aircraft," so on and so forth. And then September 11th happened, and she said, "You fly armed, right?" I said, "Oh, yeah." And she said, "Can you bring 2 guns? "Yeah, Mom, I can do that." "Can you bring your friends with guns?" "Yeah, Mom, I can do that." "Can you give me a gun?" "No, Mom, I'm not going to do that." No, but honestly, she what a great lady to deep into her 50s to want to take on a challenge like being a flight attendant. There's no harder job, if you ask me, than in the service industry, and which all of us are in, right? So a couple of housekeeping things. The restrooms are down the hall to the left. If you need parking, hopefully you're all parked, but if you need parking, we have plenty of parking in the front, plenty of parking in the side. If you want to get up, get a drink, use the restroom, it's real informal. So I appreciate you all being here. I'm just going to go through, if you don't know what NVIDIA is about, we'll go through a couple slides and kind of tell you about some of the things that we're doing. We're a visual computing company. More than likely, in your computer, your laptop, your desktop, the thing that's running the graphics for your computer is an NVIDIA product. But that's not all we do. Of course, we're in gaming. Of course, we're in entertainment and enterprise graphics, which is like model building and things like that for architecture and large projects. But we make data centers go really, really fast. And if you're familiar with DCs, some of our friends from Amazon, Apple, Google, Facebook, you understand how important it is to have fast data centers and secure data centers. But we're also in automotive. That's our big new line this year. We're going to make the Google car not crash, hopefully. So basically, all of these cameras that are on these cars are taking in data really, really fast. And you have to make split-second decisions. As we all know as drivers, you have to make split-second decisions. So our products are in some very high-end cars. I have some products, the automotive products that we're in, on another slide. But Tesla is our main backer, and we're really innovative with the way that we market these things and do these things and process the things that are going on. So I'm just going to skip through some of the higher level stuff and talk about some of our really cool products. Our friends from Apple, thank you, first of all. This is not a representative slide. That we're not trying to knock you. We're just showing what our stuff does. And let me say, too, by the way, our friends from Apple, huge round of applause for them. They came through the 12th hour helping us out and putting everything together, paying for a lot of things with this event, and made it absolutely possible. So let's give them a round. So one of our products is a set-top box called the Shield. It makes it really cool if you're into gaming at all. But if you're not into gaming, buy the product anyways. But you can get all these great apps on here, and they go really, really fast. The cool thing about it is that you don't have to start it up and wait for it to start and wait for things to power up. It comes on, and it's on, and you're streaming immediately. Cool data center stuff. A lot of people aren't aware. I put this up here. They're talking about the graphics, but anybody know what movie this is? Gravity, right? Any movie in Hollywood that wins an Academy Award, for the last 10, 15 years, the graphics in that movie are made with NVIDIA products. So we, by proxy, are winning major industry awards. And if you know anything about the movie Gravity, if you've seen it, great movie, Sandra Bullock's in it. Almost the whole thing is computer generated, but it looks incredibly real. We have a new building going up across the street. This is some of the interiors of the building. And what's important about that is when we came up with this crazy idea to design a new building, we also came up with a crazy idea on how to design it. And we basically designed it in virtual reality. And you can put on VR goggles and you can walk through the building. The building's not up, but it has real texture and feel. The light that comes into the building through skylights, that's all rendered in real time. You can change the sunlight, change the time of day, change the time of year. And that way you can see and understand, okay, we're doing these things that will have a long-lasting effect. Are we doing the right thing? All powered by NVIDIA graphics. More importantly than any of the cool video game stuff is what we're doing in science. I would like to think that cancer touches us all in some way. We have friends, we have family that are victims of this terrible disease. And I'd like to think that NVIDIA is gonna have a hand in killing cancer. Our GPUs are helping doctors and scientists visualize the cancer cells. And they're decoding the human genome. They're doing all this great computing around cancer research. And not only do we give our products to these research opportunities, we fund cancer research through some of the charitable things that NVIDIA does. But I'm convinced that in our lifetime, maybe even the next couple years, I hope, that we will see an end to this terrible disease that does affect us. And of course, automotive we talked about. And not only, this is the Tesla graphics display, heads-up display. We power that as well as doing the cameras on self-driving cars. And that's what the Drive PX product is. What's great about NVIDIA, when I first joined, I had no real experience in private sector. I came out of government, obviously. So we started talking, they started telling me about this thing called Project Inspire. And I was like, what is this? And this is what's great about NVIDIA is that rather than doing a Christmas party every year, all the NVIDIANs get together in December and we go do a project someplace in Silicon Valley. It happened the last couple of times we've done it in East San Jose, and we'll go to a school and we'll completely renovate that school. We'll give them computers, we'll make the grounds look nice, we'll plant gardens. And the employees are the ones doing 90% of the work. We have a planning team that does this year round, but the employees said, we don't want to do go offsite and do a ball or do a luncheon or a dinner or some event. We want to go give back to the community. And so I implore everybody within your organization, try to do something similar. Try to give back to the community. And that's all we're doing here, right? We're giving back to the community. A little bit about our company and what we do and how we do it. As you know, some of the things that are on here make pretty unique security challenges. So the security team here is growing and building, and we want to continue in that direction as the company is growing and building, and new risks are presented every day. So we have to be nimble, we have to be flexible, And we have to be at the pointy end of the spear, to use a military term. So any questions on NVIDIA? Great. I have one more request for everybody that I'm going to show you a video. Today, it's a little rough for me, so today is the fifth anniversary of a person who supported my old career field in the Air Force. Her name is Tara Brown, and she was a master sergeant in Afghanistan. And did that go up? She was killed 5 years ago today. And going through my Facebook links, I didn't really even realize it, that she this was the anniversary of her death. She was supporting building operations in Afghanistan, she was taken out by a gunman, unfortunately. But I thought I'd play a little bit of a tribute to her. There are very few people within Air Force OSI who were killed in action, and we have even fewer females. Unfortunately, besides Tara, we had a female killed in December in Afghanistan by a suicide bomber attack. So this is very real for our folks and troops overseas. But I thought this is a fitting audience to honor Master Sergeant Brown's legacy in her life, and try and be better every day because of it. There's no sound to the video, so I'll just play it. It'll tell a little bit about her. So with that, I ask all of us to remember our partners overseas and here in the States that are sacrificing their lives every day, and that we're here today at this conference to support things like this, and to have a great conversation, and to make things better for the people that are going to come behind us. So if you have any questions, please feel free to let me know. If not, I'm going to turn it over to Doug Vincent from ASIS International.
Thank you. Hard to follow that. Didn't know. How old were you? If you have a daughter that's almost 20, because you look like you're like 21 right now.
I think we had it when we were 18. That's the story I tell. My wife gets really annoyed. We were 22. It was a long time ago.
Well, you age well.
Thank you.
Well, good morning. Those of you who know me, I know that I'm not, you know, don't really like to talk very much. So, and if you don't know me, it probably means you're not a member. So my name is Doug Vincent. I'm the 2016 president of the board of directors for the San Francisco Bay Area chapter of ASIS. Very proud to be here at NVIDIA and see the inaugural year of the Women in Security Conference. This is an event that has been in a plan for in the works for I would say over a year now. Our past chapter president, Matt Livermore, asked Kim Whitworth to be a part of this and get this thing going, and I'm blown away. This is a huge attendance, so probably the largest attendance I've had to speak in front of this year. So San Francisco Bay Area chapter is the fourth largest chapter in the world. So we have just under 750 members assigned to the chapter. ASIS affords many training and networking opportunities, as well as being a vehicle to promote organizations and share industry best practices. We have many active groups in the chapter, like mentorship, young professionals, certifications, and the Women in Security group, just to name a few. The women in security group is fundamentally important because the security industry has been dominated by, it's been a male-dominated industry for many years. We are now starting to see rising stars in both law enforcement and the private sector who are serving as chief of police, physical security managers, physical security directors, and IT security leaders. I have personally been influenced by women leaders in our industry. People like Robin Zonick, formerly of Apple, and Black Bag, Ronnie Davis at Synopsys, and Shadi Hayden at Adobe. All of them have played a role, you know, with their guidance, mentorship, and friendship in for the reasons why I'm here today. Now it's time for people like myself and this great organization to invest time and resources in the development of our current and future women leaders, some of whom are present here today. I would like to thank our corporate sponsorship for this event, NVIDIA, for the venue. Certainly, thank you very much, Scot. So, G4S, AMAG Technology, Smarter Security, Apple, Pixar, Hewlett-Packard, and Walmart e-commerce. Without your support, events like this and other ASIS activities would not be possible. So thank you very much. You give the sponsors a hand, please. So if anybody has a question about becoming a member with ASIS, the benefits that it offers, certainly during a break or at some point during the event, reach out and talk to me. I got a stack of cards over here. And we also have our mentorship chair, Michelle Geckler, is in the house. And we also have other chapter leadership here. I have Anjanette Brennan, who's the secretary of the board of directors this year. Lastly, I want to thank Kim Whitworth with G4S and Elena Forrest with Pixar. Your timeless efforts in bringing this event to fruition is appreciated. And the commitment to the advancement of women leaders in our industry is exemplary. So thank you for your time. Enjoy the event. And hopefully I'll get to talk to if most of you, if not all of you, at some point. I'm going to now turn it over to Kim Whitworth, the Women in Security Chair. And do you have a mic? Do you want to just... She has a mic, so thank you.
Thank you, Scot and Doug, for those kind words and information. Can everybody hear me okay? Yeah, okay. Is that better? Imposter phenomenon, now often referred to as imposter syndrome, is a term that was coined in 1978 by two clinical psychologists, Dr. Pauline Clance and Dr. Suzanne Imes. Their hypotheses surfaced after taking a sample size of over 150 women, so about as many women as are in this room today, who had earned PhDs in various specialties, were medical students, as well as professional women in fields such as law, anthropology, nursing, counseling, social work, among others. Their subjects were all primarily white, middle upper class women between the ages of 20 and 45. Straight from their publication titled The Imposter Phenomenon in High Achieving Women, Dynamic and Therapeutic Intervention, this is what they had to say about it. The term imposter phenomenon is used to designate an internal experience of intellectual phonies, which appears to be particularly prevalent and intense among a select sample of high-achieving women. Certain early family dynamics and later introjection of societal sex role stereotyping appear to contribute significantly to the development of the imposter phenomenon. Since success for women is contradicted by societal expectations and their own internalized self-evaluations, it is not surprising that women in our sample need to find explanation for their accomplishments other than their own intelligence. What is more interesting is how they felt the theory applied to men. They explained, the question has been raised as to whether or not men experience this phenomenon. In our clinical experience, we have found that the phenomenon occurs with much less frequency in men than when it does in men, and that when it does occur, it is with much less intensity. Thus, unlike men, who tend to own success as attributable to a quality inherent in themselves, women are more likely to project the cause of success outward to an external cause, luck, or to a temporary internal quality, effort, that they do not equate with inherent ability. The proposed theory of Dr. Clance and Dr. Imes suggests something very important, and I believe also ties in most likely why most of us are here today. It is not necessarily imposter phenomenon that is so vital to understand, but rather the implications about how it originated and why it still exists today. In order to grow, we must collectively recognize that we live in a society that nurtures a culture plagued by assumptions about women and their inherent abilities. A culture that often defines and dictates how women should think, how they should behave, how they should look, and most certainly what particular professions and fields of work they are best suited to. And it is of my opinion that these expectations and seeming guidelines are far more stringent for women than they are for men. The repercussions of stepping outside of this framework of perceived femininity have created suffering, endless self-doubt, and a dangerous embedded belief among many women that they simply cannot, or at least should not, be equally or more successful than men. Well, if any of you in the audience today has ever felt this way, this panel of amazing women to my right might change your mind for the better. Though the need to address the imperfections within our aggregate society remain, it seems unfair if we do not also point out the progress we have achieved. In fact, since I was asked to become chair of the Women in Security Committee just 18 short months ago, we have put on 3 Women in Security events. The first gathering was an open invitation to all women in the industry to have dinner and drinks in San Francisco. Well, 7 people showed up that night, and the first one to RSVP is someone you'll be hearing from in just a little bit. Thank you, Elena.
I'm there.
The second event was a similar situation, and it was meant to facilitate introductions and networking over drinks and dinner in Palo Alto. 26 women showed up to that one. Well, here we are today at technically our 3rd, but actually our 1st annual Women in Security Conference in all of the as-is San Francisco Bay Area chapter's history. And as I look around the room at the nearly 200 people who wanted to make time to be a part of this day, I feel pretty confident that we're going in the right direction. Before I pass the floor over to Stephanie, I just want to thank all of our incredibly generous sponsors for their enthusiasm and support. NVIDIA, Pixar, Apple, AMAG, Smarter Security, As-Is, Walmart, Hewlett-Packard, eBay, and G4S all contributed to make this day possible. And a very special thank you to Elena Forrest and Scott Walker, who worked tirelessly behind closed doors to help pull this off. I'm so grateful and could not have done it without both of you guys. That being said, I hope each one of you walks away today with a full stomach, a few souvenirs, and some new ways to think about how to promote the deserving women in your lives. Thanks very much.
So I think we've just changed the order, the running order. So I'm Fiona Walters. You can tell I was born and raised in Mississippi. And sometimes, as a Brit working in the US, that's what it feels like. You know, it's one of the things I want to touch on a bit later is kind of how we're raised and how our identity is built from where we're from. It's not necessarily our gender and our makeup. It's, you know, it's often about the things that our grandma taught us, right? So anyway, I work with G4S, but I joined actually G4S almost by accident on a 5-month temporary contract to help start up a business in the US, in the UK. And I'm here 24 years later, still with the same business, but actually having achieved a ton of stuff that I probably would not have achieved anywhere else. And so there's a huge shout out to the business because they had confidence in me and were able to give me opportunities that I probably may not have had elsewhere. And if that's blaming external circumstances, I don't know. But really, it's been a great journey, and I've got to do a lot of things that I just didn't expect to do in my career, which I think is a great thing. So just a little bit about background, and it'll sort of tie into some of the things that we're going to talk about later. But I was promoted pretty quickly in G4S, and it had some challenges, right? Why were they promoting me? She was brand new into the business. How on earth could she kind of have worked her way up on that basis? And, you know, that brought some real challenges, both in terms of, I think, some of the things Kim's talked about in terms of confidence, but also in terms of how you build your brand in an organization. And I think one of the things that's really important for anyone, women, men, in an organization is how you build your brand. How do you build and understand how you're perceived by your peer group, by the employees that work with you, and by your bosses, the people that are going to take decisions perhaps about your career? And I think we talk a lot about women having to work harder perhaps than men to get the same sort of recognition. That's how we feel, whether it's true or not, is another question. And I think in my career, if I look back on some things, I would say that actually, yeah, I fully believed I had to work 10 times harder than anybody else to be able to progress in the organization. I'm not sure that was the reality if I look back on things now. And I can remember very vividly one of the chaps that I worked with had been given a task, and he said, let's just give that to Fiona, she'll stay up all night to do this. And at that point, I thought, hang on a minute, there's a problem. You know, and it wasn't that I would stay up all night. The problem was that my brand was being devalued because I was devaluing it myself, actually. It wasn't about taking a leadership or a managerial position. Working really hard was almost devaluing my position as a leader in the organization or my position as a manager. And so I think getting that balance right as part of our brand building is a really important part of what we need to do as women in any organization. I think the other thing is that very often women end up in functional roles versus operational roles in businesses. And you see lots of women progress through the HR or the finance or legal functions, business development sometimes. But there's very few women in many of our peer companies that are actually running businesses. So one of the things that I would challenge everybody to do is to learn how to do that. Because all of the stakeholders we work with are running a business. They might be running a function, they might be running areas, but try and look for opportunities where you can run a profit and loss, where you can take responsibility for employees, and look for areas where you can contribute to the running of an operation, because it gives you insight into how a business should operate. And whether you're in security or you move into other parts of the organization, that insight is incredibly important in decision making and helping you influence other people in your organization. And that's one of the things that I'm really grateful to G4S for. I worked hard for it, but G4S had enough confidence in me to give me an operation, and I ran it and did well and moved on and did something else. And then I think one of the other things I want to touch on is working globally. Obviously, the world's getting smaller. We kind of work in an organizations today where we have instantaneous communication with people thousands and thousands of miles away. And we assume that that communication is given and taken in the way that we wrote it, or in the way that we, when we pick up the phone and we communicate with folks, we assume that they'll understand it the same way we intended it. And there's a lady who wrote, and a psychologist who wrote a book called The Loudest Duck. Has anybody come across the book called The Loudest Duck? So it's called The Loudest Duck because in China, men are raised by their grandmothers or their mothers to be humble and to not say too much, and to be reserved and not to be too vocal about things, because the loudest duck gets shot and you don't want to be shot, right? So, and then women are raised to be humble as well, but to, you know, but that's a cultural difference, right? In America, men are raised to be vocal, to say what you think, to be there out in front of things. Most times women aren't raised that way. In the UK, we play football. If anybody wants to, we play soccer. It's really called football everywhere else, but but you know, if somebody wants to ask me about the offside rule for soccer, I'm happy to talk about it all day. Ask me about the rules for American football and I'm out of things. All of these bonds that are built in organizations and built in teams are based on some of these commonalities. They're based on the things that people do together. And the minority is the person who doesn't do that. So me moving from the UK to the US to run a business that was in trouble and to try and build networks and everything else, I was having to learn a whole new set of social norms and social experiences that allow you to fit in. So it's not necessarily about being a woman, it's about being different. And so think about the things in your day-to-day and my day-to-day interactions with our team members and the people that we work with that make us different or make us the same, and how do we build those bridges? Because those things, that relationship building in any business becomes incredibly important to success. And so if you get a chance to read The Loudest Duck, it's not, I mean, there's things that I don't necessarily agree with in the book, but it's a very good representation of how you have, you know, some of the skills and things that you might want to put into play to kind of help understand how to work in teams in your business. So our security industry has been slow to change, and in some ways that's helped us, I think. Change has been slow historically. Change is moving very fast now. And so things are changing, and the skills that we need as women are changing. If we're not tech savvy today, if we don't understand some of the things that are impacting decisions in our security department that are not the same decisions that we were taking 5 years ago, because the external threats, the external things are different today, then we're not adding value as an employee, male or female. Doesn't matter. We have to be expert in the things that we do, and we have to be open and adaptable to changing and learning those new things. One of the things that is in the back to the Loudest Duck book is that quotas don't work. You know, we're not going to have so many females, so many males, so many minorities of whatever nationality. That's not the way that you build an inclusive business. And within a security department, we have so many stakeholders that we have to work with. We have to build those bridges in order to have an effective security framework across any of our organizations. So that adaptability is going to become more important as we bring in, you know, us baby boomers or Gen Xers are going to be moving on, and the millennials and Gen Zs are coming in. They work differently to the way we do. They have a different view about work-life balance. They have a different view about how they want to work. if we want to add value to our organization, we have to understand and learn these things and learn how to be able to bring that into our security decision making every day. And I think the other thing, you know, so all of these things lead to that kind of adaptability and competence, which I know is going to be touched on later on. But also being authentic. We need to be true to ourselves. Yes, we might be different, but we need to be authentic. We don't change ourselves to fit in, but we do adapt to make sure that we can work together. And if you want to work in a global environment, I think there's a few things that it's worth thinking about building, some skills to build. Obviously, being a learn things about security expertise, look at the global security threat environment. What's changing? What's different today than it was yesterday? What are the threats that companies are going to be facing tomorrow? Because they are going to be different. Change is happening fast, so you need to be adaptable. You need to work with ambiguity. There isn't a legacy that says this is the way that it's always going to be done, because the things that we're facing today are different from some of the things we've faced in the past. The shareholder or stakeholder influencing and influencing skills, think hard about building those. How do we influence the people that impact the decisions that we make so that they can be part of the solution? Be inclusive but decisive. Cultural awareness, language skills, if you can build them, would be great if you want to work globally. And then business and management skills, as I touched on earlier, if you get the chance to get that experience, it's invaluable. And obviously, understanding the drivers of a global economy and a global security environment. So those are just some of the things that I've learned through my career and things that I kind of have thought about. I'm happy to take questions after, but I'll pass on to Tammy for her next steps.
Thank you, Fiona. So good morning, everybody, and I really appreciate the opportunity to talk with you all today. You know, my journey started as a special agent with Naval Investigative Service, NIS. And many of you all know that now as NCIS, Naval Criminal Investigative Service. And if you've watched any of those episodes on TV now that Hollywood has discovered us, you'll know that that's exactly how my career path went. Absolutely. And also, I worked side by side with Mark Harmon every day, and we solved every case within an hour. So that's from whence I came. But no, I do remember, and this was so interesting, Kim, to hear about this imposter phenomenon, because about what we're about to describe is just exactly that, and just was very fascinating to hear that. I remember, walking into our training academy in Glencoe, Georgia, at FLETC, that first day, and the agent NIS at that time was about 2,000 agents, and less than 10% were women in that agent corps, and our full class represented that percentage pretty accurately. And I remember walking into in that first day, and side by side with my male counterparts, all of whom had, well, most of whom had zero experience, as I did. We came in having had no law enforcement background or what have you. But my perception and what I had bought into was, because it's a male-dominated field, that I felt that I had to prove myself, and that person, that male agent that walked in with me, he had more credibility than I did just walking in the door, and that I was lacking in some way. And certainly, my tact or my attitude was, I need to overcompensate. I need to go above and beyond and work harder and do better just to build credibility and build a reputation that I was a competent agent. So my tact certainly was to overcompensate. I was assigned at one point with NIS in Yokosuka, Japan. And I remember being the duty agent one weekend and getting a call from my SAC saying, hey, the base commander needs you to respond to the base. There's a cave that he's discovered, and he thinks that it's harboring some criminal and or some war relic who doesn't realize a war is over, or some Marine has gone AWOL, and you need to check it out. And I, okay, that's an interesting, I drew the short straw on that one for sure. And I don't know if any of you are familiar with the base there at Yokosuka, but it's riddled with caves, and they've tried to seal them all off. And those caves were utilized in the war as hospital caves, and so they're everywhere. And apparently they missed one. So I got to the location, and I was assuming that, you know, that classic cave and, you know, the Roadrunner, where it's the side of the mountain and you just walk in, was what I was going to discover. It wasn't that at all. In fact, what it was a hole in the ground, and I had to, a small hole in the ground, but it indeed had a rope that was lowered into it, that was attached to a tree, so and all these power cords going down into the hole. So clearly there was something going on there. And the base commander standing there and very eager for me to get down there. I've got the crime scene kit, and I've got my photo bag on me, and I've got my weapon on me. I'm all decked out, and I'm supposed to lower myself into this hole by myself. And hey, I'm on it. I'm going to go in there, which I did. I lowered myself in there, and what I would hope would happen would be to cavern out and get a little bit bigger. In fact, what happened was it got smaller and smaller and smaller in there, to the point where it bottlenecked, and I had the only way I could advance into the cave to go further was to be lying on my back, inching my way down with the ceiling of that cave inches from my face. Not only did it bottleneck, but then there was a hairpin turn right after I got through that bottleneck that then completely cut off the light for the escape route out. So now I'm in darkness if I choose to continue going. And then there's a ledge that you have to jump down to just to get in. So that's where I was, but I hadn't gotten that far. I didn't even know how bad it was about to get. But I'm in this bottleneck, and I'm looking at the ceiling that was right in my face, and the only thing I could think of was, Japan is the land of earthquakes. And how likely is it right about now one of those is going to hit? That was one. The second thought was, it is also the land of poisonous centipedes, and they love living in caves like this. And so that one went through my mind. And frankly, I froze for a while and just lying there like, I really don't want to do this, and I really don't want to do this. So interestingly, my mind then went to what's going to happen on Monday morning when I meet up with my squad mates, all of which were male agents, and of course talked about this duty call that was so rare and unique. And what went through my mind, and what frankly motivated me to continue going, was I am not going to be ridiculed for turning around and not doing this duty call. I am going to continue on. I'm going to make sure that I do this, because of course they would, and of course I will not be remembered for my tour in Japan for not going into that cave. So that's how that's what pushed me on to go in. And ultimately I resolved the duty call. And by the way, it wasn't a war relic who didn't realize the war was over, and it wasn't some AWOL Marine, and it wasn't a criminal harboring or hiding out. It was actually the teenage kids and they're all officers' kids at a little clubhouse. And by the way, the fridge was full of beer. And that's where those plug-ins for those extension cords were going to. So they were actually quite you know, innovative with how they managed a little clubhouse, but the gig was up. So anyway, sure enough, on Monday morning, my squad mates and I were talking about it, and I remember describing it to them, and what was so interesting was their reaction. And the reaction was, oh my God, you can't pay me enough. I would have never gone down there. I would have walked away and said, forget it, I'm not going in. And it was such a surprise to me, because I was just like, I had bought into this thing. Well, because you're a male, and because you're, you know, I'm working this male-dominated field, that of course they would have gone in. It would have been adventuresome and so forth. And they said, all of them said, I would have walked away. I don't know what you were thinking, Tammy, you went down in there. So it was a really interesting experience, a kind of a wake-up call for me to say, well, I'm buying into this stuff, right? That didn't change the fact, though, that throughout my career, certainly with NIS and since then in the private sector, that that, you know, my tack was always to overcompensate and try and do more and above. And there's, by the way, that's not a bad thing, right? So we want to succeed. We want to be competitive. We want to show our value. So it worked for me. And I've seen other tacks that other of my female counterparts with NIS took that maybe weren't as successful trying to take on that role of a male. And it wasn't authentic, to your comments, Fiona, about it wasn't authentic to them. And sometimes then they came across as aggressive or harsh. And that's not a good thing, because that reputation and your brand stays with you, and that's hard to change. So around the 9 or 10 year mark in the public sector role here, I thought and found that there might be broader opportunity in the private sector, and then focus my career path in that direction. And I, you know, in the private or the public sector, it is still a male-dominated field, and that comes with challenges. And how do you navigate through that? How do you sort through that? How do you build rapport? Because relationship is so important with those people that you work closely with and on your team. How do you build rapport? And certainly, again, my perception was, well, if I can't talk sports like you can, Fiona, if I can't talk sports, or I don't know how to operate a power tool, how am I going to build a relationship with my male counterparts, right, frankly? And I know that's overgeneralizing and really not accurate, but it kind of is in some weird little slice of a way, right? So really, it really comes down to, I think, some basics. And this applies to everybody. It doesn't apply just to women, but it applies to all of us who want to do well and build a reputation, build credibility, and do what we do at the best that we can, provide value to our customers, our clients, our businesses. Many of you may know this as a three C's, and I actually add a fourth to it. And the first one is confidence. You know, believe in yourself. And if you don't believe in yourself, act like you believe in yourself. Have that confidence. Act confidently, even though you may not feel it all the time. And you need to be able to do that. And these all build on each other, because if you're confident, and you're confident in your ability and your skill, that's because you have confidence in your competency, right? And you know what you're doing. So, take opportunity to build your skill set and confidence and your connections, which we'll talk about in a moment. So that's one for sure. Competence is the next, and that's really, really critical. You need to know your subject matter. You know, be a subject matter expert wherever you can be. But frankly, there's so many things that we do in security, it's impossible for us to be an SME, all out everything in security. But what you should do is building those relationships, and again, those connections, that third C, is know who is the SME. If you're not it, who is it, right? Who can you go to? And be that, we call it my team, we are the solution factory. Come to us and we'll solution it for you. And I don't care if it's not a security-related issue. If you come here and it's one-stop shopping and I don't know, it's not under my purview or under my responsibility, I'm going to find out who it is and I will help you find the solution. I'm just not going to lob it over the fence and say, yep, not mine, sorry. That's not how we build relationships, not how we build credibility. So be that one-stop shopping and build those relationships. Build your competency, not only in your skill set, but also in who you know. The other is connections, and I mentioned that, we've touched on that too. You know, don't do it alone. It is essential for us to build these relationships, whether it's networking in associations like this and opportunities like this, but certainly internally in our organizations, in our functions that we partner with all the time, but absolutely with the businesses we support. How can we be credible as if we don't know the business, right? And if we don't know how the business runs, if we don't understand finance and what their goals are. Typically, and certainly in my career I've seen, and this is changing absolutely in the industry, I think, is security was perceived as, if you go to security, they're just going to say no, or they're going to make it harder. And instead, we need to be those business enablers. And if we understand the business, then we can understand what the risks are and how we can provide value. It's so hard to measure security sometimes, because sometimes a lot what we do is prevention. How do you measure prevention? So how do you add value? What can I do that's meaningful to you as a business partner and my client? How do I get a seat at the table at the beginning of whatever your project is, instead of being an afterthought at the very end, at the 11th hour, right? So how can you add value that way? The fourth C that I like to talk about is comfort zone, and that is to get out of your comfort zone. Step out. You got to grow. You have to constantly stretch yourself. And with that, I think soft skills and learning, having the hard skills, we have to have it. That's absolutely how we get our credibility. But soft skills is just as important. How do you communicate? And I will tell you, one of the challenges I have with some of my team is writing capability. How well do you write? And I will tell you, I have a reputation for, like, she's going to find that misspelled word or that comma in the wrong place, and I do every time. But is that important? Because sometimes our only exposure or our employees or those that we help, their only exposure to us might be that one email or that one memo or that one presentation. And if it's not professionally done, it doesn't look good. If we've got misspells in there, it's embarrassing. And we lose credibility just in that one glance. We only have one shot sometimes to prove our value or to make an impression. And so I'd tell you, writing skills is really right up there. Also is, of course, communication, being able to talk and have some executive presence and be succinct in your communications, be able to make presentations, be able to talk to the CEO if you run into her in the hall. I run into her now and then in the parking lot, and instead of kind of turning around and going the other way, you know, you should be going towards her and afford yourself that opportunity to talk with her. But you have to be confident to be able to do that and have something to say. Also part of soft skills I think are important is your teamwork and collaboration abilities. Sometimes you're a follower and sometimes you're a leader, but be able to work in a team and cultivate that. Fiona talked about adaptability, and I can't say how important I think that is as well, especially for those of us who are more seasoned professionals in this realm and how fast the security landscape is changing. We have to show that we have a passion for learning, a passion for adapting, and that we are still relevant, right? And that's connecting with not only the people and networking that we talked about, but also information. You know, leverage the internet that we have today. There's blogs and there's forums and there's all kinds of different platforms that we can draw from and stretch our skill set. Problem solving is absolutely another one on the list here for soft skills. And some of that, and I've seen it, and try to talk to my team about it, which is, hey, just don't call me up and say, I've got this problem, this thing happened. When I get that phone call from you, what I'd like to hear is, there's this thing that happened, and here's what I think here's some options that I think we could do to resolve it. And that just takes you to the next step, and again, that adding value. Look a little more holistically about what the issue is, and that'll just make you grow, and then it takes you farther. Part of that too is that part of that what I just discussed is a critical observation, and that's that holistic approach. So if you're asked to, we're asked to do these all the time. Give me a spreadsheet of all the outsourced service guard services and where we're located. All this is a huge spreadsheet. And if I just deliver it and drop it on your desk, that provides some of the value, just a slice of. But if you take a look at analyzing it, interpreting it, and now there's questions, as I looked at the data and what it's telling me, it means this or says that, and providing a summary and your perception or analytics on what it means. Again, that's adding value. And then conflict resolution. Seek those opportunities for win-win-wins. So that's a win of the individual, the win for the organization, the win for the company. Are you good at negotiating? Are you good at persuading? And work on that if you're not. You know, one of the things that I did want to mention too, besides, and I think this is an individual, it doesn't matter if it's gender related or anything else. I think this is just good rules to follow if you want to succeed in your career. But as women too, and I meant to mention earlier, is we certainly have the unique challenge and choice points if we choose to have a family. And that sometimes can be a job progression staller, so to speak, if we make those choices. And that's hard to do, and the perceptions around that, because we are typically in that caregiver role. Let's make it a little more complicated. How about being a single mom? So that's what I'm a single mom. And one of the difficulties I have and that I'm careful to do is I don't bring my challenges with childcare, what have you, to work at all. In fact, I just keep it as invisible as I possibly can, because the perception, and sometimes, you know, I can say it's may have even been concrete experience on my part, is perhaps I get passed over for a project I really wanted to work on, or some travel overseas, or other opportunities, because the perception is I won't be available or I can't be available because I have to fill in the blank with regard to child care and availability. So that's a challenge, and there's some choice points that we make as women to have that family and to be that child care giver. And oftentimes that's where our husbands' careers have take precedence. So I don't know that it has to be that way, but certainly there's a perception there that's a challenge for us. So in my role, with HPE, I have a real privilege and opportunity, I think duty, to develop my team and provide opportunity for competent hires for diversity. Diversity is strength, frankly, from my perception and how we build our teams. But an opportunity to actually have an impact with regard to guiding the development of my team members, taking a look at what their challenges might be, and everything from in-house training to external training. The global reach piece is so important. We are the world is getting smaller, as Fiona had mentioned, and many of those folks on my team haven't traveled internationally or haven't had any experience dealing with different cultures. So affording them opportunities to do that, whether it's inviting their counterparts from other regions to our face-to-face annually or letting them go, or finding projects that they have to work on a global team rather than just right there at the office, is opportunities I'm trying to find for them. We have a very strong mentorship program, ASIS does as well, and availing ourselves of that, I think, is really important. There's many other things, I think, that we do, certainly, and I think others would, in this arena with regard to how we develop our team and opportunities. Internship program, hiring early career, so right out of college, has really brought some depth and breadth in our organization that we never saw coming, but it's just been incredible. So anyway, the landscape that we work in, security is changing so much with the age of technology and information. We will get calls from our VP sometimes about a security incident that happened somewhere else in the world before we have seen it or heard it yet. It hasn't got to us yet, and that's an uncomfortable place to be. We want to be the ones in the know. We want to be the messengers and telling how we're going to resolve it. But it's frankly that fast moving, and that it shifts so quickly, and we have to be fast and nimble. We have to be strong in our subject matter. We have to be adaptable. And frankly, a big part of how we do that is being connected like we are and sharing best practices with each other. We should all be in it together and helping each other because we all face similar issues and challenges. So thank you for your time.
Good morning still. So as my bio talked about, I spent 29 years in law enforcement in two different agencies. I led both operations, support services, budget, emergency management, media relations, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, whatever they wanted to throw at me, personnel and training. And I had a few first females in both of those jobs. I was the first female defensive tactics instructor at Palo Alto. I was the first supervisor for the fatal accident team. And then in Los Gatos, I was the first female SWAT commander that the department had ever had. And how I gained some, just a side note, how I gained some reputation with that is that I went to a team training and I rappelled off of a 70-foot tower. And it was a free fall rappel and scared the crap out of me. But it showed the team that I was willing to do something scary and that I trusted them. And so that was an interesting point in my career, and I really loved being in charge of the SWAT team. They taught me a lot, but it was great. I also had the really wonderful opportunity to travel across the country, go to a lot of leadership courses, FBI National Academy, Boston, the Police Forum for Executives, and also LAPD West Point program. In addition to that, I was involved as a student and as a facilitator in the International Chiefs of Police Violence Against Women Initiative. And so I was able to meet a lot of people across the country in that role as well. And then I co-founded the Women Leaders in Law Enforcement Symposium, and that just celebrated a 10-year anniversary last fall. And this year we hope to have 900 people in San Diego for that. And that concept, that grassroots effort, started on a cocktail napkin. God, there's a whole thing about cocktails here. I'm just want to warn you, I am not an alcoholic. I play one on TV. But anyway, that dream started on a napkin in 1985, and it started out with like 20 people at a hotel bar, and then it moved up and up and up, and then so now we're looking at 900 people this year, and that's what this can do. So keep the dream alive. We're going to dream big, ladies and gentlemen. We're going to make this happen the same way that hopefully the Women Leaders Conference has done for this state. Along the way, I spent 6 years on the board of directors for the YWCA of Silicon Valley, which helps young women, their families, young girls survive domestic violence, sexual assault, human trafficking. They also provide childcare services, and also I think one of the things that's really big for me now that I'm at Pixar is a organization within that agency called Tech Girls, which gets young girls, middle school and high school, into the whole STEAM program. So I really support that as well. So all of those experiences and opportunities will drive me to what I'm going to talk about primarily, or the three points of success, which are mentoring, relationships, and networking. And as you saw me kind of buzzing around the room before we started, I mean, that I thought, well, if I'm going to talk about this, I better, you know, walk my walk. So that's why I bugged you guys and introduced myself. But that's really what this is all about for me. So my points will be about that. So the mentoring piece is that, you know, being a female in a male-dominated profession and now in this industry as well, it was really important for me to have mentors along the way. And the issue with that, though, being in a male-dominated profession, I didn't have a lot of female mentors. I had a couple. They were great. But back in the day when I first started in law enforcement, it was a lot of stepping on top of each other to get to the next promotion, backstabbing, that kind of thing, which really doesn't work very well. But mostly I had men who were great mentors. And I still have, one of my best mentors is still a good friend today. And I lean on him a lot and we text each other and call. And he was wonderful. He's been wonderful. And the thing about mentors is they're not just going to show up in spandex, you know, with a cape with a big M on it at your doorstep and say, I'm your mentor. You know, you have to seek them out. You have to observe. What I did was I looked and I observed and I watched people and I saw where they were going in their trajectory of their career. And I thought, I want to follow that person. And so then I would say, hey, would you mind having coffee with me and just tell me where do I need to improve? This is what I want to do next. What can I do to make myself better? Help me along that route. And that's what essentially happened. And that's how I got to where I am today. The thing about mentorship versus coaching, and I'll make a clarification in my mind what I think it is that, you know, coaching is kind of like you're in a position and based on your hierarchy or whatever in your work, you have coaches who will guide you and teach you and direct you and all that. But a mentor to me is someone who you can call in the middle of the night. If you're stressed out, they'll look at your resume, they'll look at your LinkedIn profile. You know, you can get together with them any time of the day or night, and they're going to help you, promote you, get you in the door, invite you to things, to, you know, things like this, and really help you long term, not just when you're at a position in your job. So a mentor should also help network. And I wouldn't be here today without a strong networking group. I was just talking to the Apple ladies here about Dave Gulo. Dave is with Apple Security. What's funny? Dave was the chief of police in Calum, but I knew him years before. Well, he's one of the reasons why I'm sitting here today. He's one of the reasons why I was able to work and have worked at the Oscars for the last 7 years. It's actually more like his wife helped me get to the Oscars, but to get to my dream job at Pixar. And so it was really important to have someone talk to me about planning ahead, figuring out what I wanted to do. And once I became competent and had a reputation for where I was, then I would start to look ahead. And how could I get there? What could I do? Before I retired from law enforcement in 2012, in 2011, I started working part-time in two different fields. I was in technical writing, and then I went into security. I also was still, you know, working as a captain. I was on the YWCA board. It just so happened I got married that year, and then my mom got sick and passed away too in 2011. I do not recommend that path for anybody. You know, I was going way overboard with everything I was trying to do. That whole work-life balance thing just didn't exist in 2011. But what it did is it got me into this wonderful security field, and it took me to SIS and then eventually to Pixar. So the other thing about planning ahead is I'm always thinking about what I'm going to do next. It's not that I'm just going to spend, like, you know, 2 minutes in one job and then kind of get to know it and then move on. I feel like I've had a pretty good track record of staying in a job for a long time. But I'm always thinking ahead about what do I want to do and how do I want to stretch. And so once I obtained the position or whatever, I would start to just ask my mentor, what do you think I'm good at that's different than this? And help me get there. And who do you know in that profession, et cetera? So here's what worked for me. Raising my hand, asking for the stretch goals, going to any training that I possibly could, even if I had to pay for it myself, attending conferences like these, joining associations, and just being open to meeting new people. And so I want to ask a question right now. How many people are sitting with the people that you work with all the time? Raise your hands. Apple. Uh-huh. You too. Right? This is what we do. And it's just kind of natural. We want to stick with our people, right? We don't want to branch out. But that's the only way that you're going to be able to branch out in your careers or wherever you want to go, your hopes and dreams, whatever, even if it's not in security, if you want to do something completely different. So at lunchtime, I want all of you all to sit separately. You two have to split up and meet. Here's the goal. Meet two people you don't know. Get their business cards. Just that's the goal for lunchtime. Okay? It'll make a difference. You never know who you're going to meet that may come down the road and help you in some way. It happens all the time. So here's what else what worked for me, being a lifelong learner, joining, again, professional associations, reading a lot of journals, articles, et cetera, getting out of my comfort zone, as Tammy mentioned, and being the go-to person for your boss. You want to be the go-to, and that will get you ahead of the game, I think. So then the last thing is power of relationships, and it is all about relationships. And I learned that in January in 2004 at the FBI National Academy. I had an instructor who just sat there one day and looked at all of us and said, it's all about relationships. Don't think it's about anything else. And I thought, well, you know, it's so simple, but that really resonated. And I thought, well, I have good working relationships, but I was very task-oriented, super task-oriented. And my assistant is sitting right there. She's probably thinking to herself, you are still task-oriented. But I feel like I have much more of deeper, powerful relationships with people because I've kind of gotten out of that mode of being so task-driven. Speaking of assistants, does everybody know it's Administrative Assistant Day today? If you don't, if you're a boss, you still have time to get something on the way home and make sure you get it to them. So anyway, I have this mantra that, you know, I don't like to burn bridges because, again, you never know who's going to be in front of you someday at that oral board panel or that interview where you cut somebody off in the parking lot and then you walk in and then you're meeting with your new boss and you're like, oh, crap. So just be kind and professional. Don't step on people to get to where you need to be. Help them. And be a mentor to other women and men in your profession and help them come with you. Just reach back and bring them along with you in whatever way you can. It's important to be a mentor. And I say that because, especially for men, and I'm so happy to see all the men in the room. This is awesome. At the Women Leaders Conference, we usually have like 5 out of 700 people come. So I applaud the men here who came and supporting this this effort. But women do have different challenges, as we're all talking about. But it's important for men to be at the table, for men to support you, and for you to support them back. It's really about supporting and inspiring each other to be the best that we can be, to achieve our hopes and dreams, do whatever we want to do. But the importance of power, the power of relationships, mentoring, and networking is huge. So thank you.
Okay, it's still morning, so I think we're good. So, you know, in the last half hour, 45 minutes, we've talked about a couple of different things. We've talked about branding, we've talked about team and competency and networking and mentorship. Alana just talked about that. And I think it all goes with an undercurrent of the change in the security industry. And you guys sitting out there today are a great reflection of how we are changing in the industry across the board. Some things that come to mind as we look at the industry across everything we do is it is becoming more and more of a discussion in the boardroom and at an elevated level in your own companies. So when you think about how do you progress, what kind of things should you learn, and we've talked about it consistently over the last 45 minutes, it really is an understanding of what your business is. What is the overarching goal for your business? Is it to make a widget? Is it to be a service provider? Is it to be a manufacturer? Understanding that that core business is your goal, and then that is your mission. And as security, you are a business enabler. We talked a little bit about that, right? How do we enable our business to run its most operational efficient, as efficient as possible, to run as quickly as it needs to run, and to change as dynamically as our business environment is constantly changing. Some of the other changes that we're seeing in the security industry is the quick evolving technology that is in place. You know, I've been in a situation where you are trying to replace tools, outdated tools, and honestly, the technology is changing in the midst of your process of making actual decisions. Are you in a position to understand what available tools are out there? Or do you have a team of people that can at least advise you? It doesn't have to be the person sitting in the office next to you. You have to kind of build a team around you. Is it outside vendors? Is it third-party consultants? It really is bringing a team together to give the best solutions possible. And that can't be something that you're expected to do by yourself. We talked a little bit about being able to drive the conversation at a much higher level in your companies. So in some industry, we see security kind of buried down in the organization, and it will take years for it to pop up. Unless, of course, you have the big one, right? When you have an incident, I can guarantee you, regardless of where you are in your specific company, you're going to be at the forefront of the discussion. So are you prepared to drive those conversations? What kind of presence do you have within your own company? Are you portraying yourself as a leader, regardless of where you are in the org chart? And can you go in front of your board? Can you go in front of your CEO, your president, your business leaders to have those very, very specific discussions? And do they trust you to be able to deliver the solutions? So really work on those skills at presentations, at being very available to senior leaders. It will assist you when you are called on the carpet when something bad happens. And it may not be something that you could have ever prevented, and it probably won't be something you could have prevented, right? It's going to be something that you're going to have to respond to. You have to be in that position. And I think some great comments are made about developing those proactive relationships, right? You don't want to be called by somebody you've never met in the company to explain yourself. You have to have all those relationships in place. And then you have to know who to call when something bad happens, right? You don't want to start introducing yourself in the midst of a crisis. You want to have your friends in the technology side. You want to have your relationships in the business side. You want to have friends in law enforcement, in intel communities, those people that can rally around you when the big one happens. So be prepared. You know, one thing I think that is very important for us to talk about is diversity in the industry. And when I say diversity, I don't mean gender diversity. I think that that is a very, very good discussion to have. I think we're all examples of how the industry is diversifying itself in the gender world, but it shouldn't be just that. I will tell you, if you walk in as a director or a leader in a security apparatus, and you were like me, former law enforcement, retired after 24 years in the FBI, and you're the youngest person in your group, you should be scared, okay? And you should be worried. You need dynamic, diverse people with different skill sets in your security apparatus. You need people that are smart and savvy about business. You need people that understand money. You need those people that are tech savvy, because that is really the emerging market with security, right? What kind of tools can you apply against your problems to really efficiently solve them? So you really need to build a team of diversely skilled people. So look for opportunities to do that. You know, I've been to a number of security conferences with my time with the FBI and then since then, and you can walk into the room and it does not look like a very diverse landscape, right? A lot of former retired law enforcement, I am included in that, right? Ladies, I mean, that's very much the history. But really, there is plenty of room at the table for people that are growing up in the industry now, and really plan on having those people lead the charge in the future. We need those people at the table. You know, I'd encourage you to really understand the money in your organizations. Money is power, and your understanding of it is very, very important. How do you leverage the assets, the financial assets in your company to enable you to be productive? And if you can speak money in your own company, it really shows that you're committed to being savvy about the business at large, and that you are thinking along with other people making those kind of decisions about the bottom line. And that really is a challenge for security. And I know you guys know that. You know, I would say if you are a woman in security, you are going to encounter at certain points resistance, right? Especially if you are leading a security function. If you walk into an environment where there is an old school, whatever that means, security philosophy, the fact that you're a woman and you're a leader in that environment will be a challenge to certain people. You have to lead confidently. You have to build internal collaboration within your own organization, but you really have to line up a network of people inside your own company that are supporters of yours. So you need people from the technical side. You need people from the financial side that really you are building your own team, your own network within your company so that they can support you when you need action. You know, I would say you have to build an environment within your organization where you can have honest relationships. You will never make all the right decisions. It is just humanly impossible. But you have to do the best you can, and you have to set up an environment where people can come into your office and have a candid conversation, even if it means disagreeing with you. There will be millions of people that will disagree with you, right? They may disagree with you about your strategy. They may disagree with you about a certain tool. They may disagree with you about other people in your own organization, how you're representing security, all different kinds of things. You have to allow an atmosphere so that you can have that candid conversation. It gives people a voice, which is very, very important. And it also just makes you sensitized to what the reality of your situation is. I think sometimes, maybe I'm speaking from personal experience here, but you can be running so hard to drive the operations, make sure that you're doing all the things that you should be doing from a task perspective, like Alana talked about, but you have to attend to the personal side of business. And you really have to allow people to talk and have a voice. But at the end of the day, you have to be honest about your reality. And I think sometimes this is really hard to do, especially when you're briefing and educating senior leadership. You want to be able to deliver good news, right? All the time. But that is not reality. And sometimes you have to be honest about what your reality is, especially if you are in a situation where you are developing a security culture, or if you might be in a company that is challenged on a security culture. You have to be honest about your reality. You have to do it tactfully. You have to come up with some, you have to have a plan and a solutions laid out, but you have to include your senior leadership in that discussion because they really have to be supporters. You know, I think one of the biggest challenges we do see in our industry is really developing that culture. You know, some of us have been in organizations where we have just from day one, security and safety is job one for the company, okay? And, you know, I know that there are certain businesses out there that function very, very well like that. But others of us, security is a pain. It's, you know, it's a nuisance and out of sight, out of mind. And in those environments, it is hard. And you need top-down assistance to really drive a culture change. And it doesn't happen overnight. So, you know, have those honest conversations within your group, but make sure you're having them at the most senior levels. You know, security is changing so quickly. I think there's great opportunity in the next coming years, not just for women, but for a whole broad spectrum of people that haven't been sitting at that table. So I look forward to the opportunities ahead, and I'm glad to be here today. So thank you.
We have some time set aside for Q&A. If anybody out of the audience would like to ask questions to any of the speakers, we would welcome those questions now.
Should I just speak really loudly? Sure.
Let me bring you a microphone because we're actually recording this, so we'll have it on video, and I'll just hand this to you while you ask your question so we can hear it.
Hi, are you planning on creating some sort of mentorship program for the young and the not so young so that they can get together and us gray hairs can help those that are moving up in the industry?
I'll defer to Doug, but ASIS does have a mentorship program that I'm actually a mentor in it right now, and
Who's the guy that does the... Oscar Villanueva is the person who kind of matches people within ASIS.
You have to be a member of ASIS to be a mentor?
Yes.
You do.
Yes. But it's a very easy process.
It is pretty easy.
The word money just popped up.
Thank you. First, I want to say what an honor it is to listen to all of you. I got into law enforcement very young, and I felt like I was the only one taking those arrows as a woman, so it's so nice to hear that I was not alone all those years. I heard a lot from all of you about buying into that perception of doing crazy things. I would not have gone into that cave. To be one of the guys or to fit in with the old school security teams. And I'm just curious, how do you address that or educate your security teams about not buying into that perception and standing on your own?
Oh, for heaven's sakes, give me one that works. That's a really good question, because some of those preconceived notions or perceptions come from your how you were raised and where you were raised and all that. So some of that's maybe somewhat insurmountable, but you may not be able to change the perception, but you can change the behavior, I would say. And frankly, you know, there's boundaries around how we treat each other and how we comport ourselves in a professional environment. But also, I think there's opportunity, and I don't say it's always that strict or rigid, but I think there's opportunity with recognizing success when there's a, you know, as we measure what we're able to in security, you know, measure our success and giving and recognizing those who were responsible for that, and whoever that was on the team or was an individual, and that individual happens to be a woman, it's chipping away at that and making those recognitions and calling them out. But certainly, I think there's boundaries with regard to, I may not be able to change your mind, but I can certainly change what your behavior should be and how you treat each other in the workplace. And maybe over time, then that continues. But certainly having that culture, building that culture that's supported, I think is a step in the right direction.
Consciously acting. When we're involved with those sorts of situations, I do think today you have to do some of those things less than we had to do maybe 30 years ago. So we're already seeing change in the industry.
The point about congratulating people and calling people out and recognizing success and being the person that sets the example of how you would like to be treated and the behaviors that you want to see within your own organization is hugely important. That role modeling capability is a really, really important part of making the change.
Since I have the mic already, I'm being afforded the opportunity to work on a global scale at this point now in other countries and stuff, and I know that some of you said that you've taken those opportunities to go globally. Is there anything, I'm working on obviously building those relationships, but any kind of challenge and any good piece of advice on overcoming some of those international global challenges with our partners around the world?
So some things not to do is go in with preconceived ideas. I think, you know, when I moved to the States, I'd worked over here for the last 10 years on and off prior to that. But I still had preconceived ideas and, you know, realizing that the country is, to all intents and purposes, 50 different countries. Every state is different. All of the cultures and everything else are very different. And understanding how you fit in that environment. I would learn as much as you can about the culture that you're going into. So we send people all over the world. You know, I've worked in a number of other countries before coming to the US, primarily on a temporary basis, but learning about those cultures, what the drivers are, the things to do and not to do, particularly as women. it's really easy to be offensive without realizing it. And so going to, particularly in the Middle East, for example, being very conscious about how you behave with the people that you're working with, and being very courteous of their beliefs and their understanding of societal roles, you know, you're not going to succeed without their support. And so really learning about those environments is in my mind, one of the most important things you can do.
Just to underscore what you're saying, Fiona, you know, doing some research. So, and if you can, if you have the ability to connect with somebody who's in your organization or outside your organization who is in that country or where you're going to be, and prepare. And some of that is just doing the research on the company, the culture, and making sure we are respectful is absolutely, because we could just step on it and lose all credibility in one fell swoop because we just did one little thing we didn't realize was not okay. But it's kind of that almost a mentorship thing where you, hey, do I know somebody? Is there going to be a meet and greet? Who am I going to shadow when I'm there? And if you can set that up ahead of time so that you're actually going with somebody who's the, you know, your contact there, a resident there, that can take you through that and help you navigate through that so that you don't step on it, essentially, that's a good start. But certainly researching in all the different ways that you could think of. So.
Thank you to the panel. A lot of this has resonated with me. I showed up in Kentucky to do an incident command training, and I had six of my counterparts. And when we signed in, he looked at the tallest, burliest guy, and he said, "You must be the IC." And then he said, "No." And then he points to me. He goes, "That's the CIC." And he goes, "Oh, the chief incident commander?" And he said, "No, the chick in charge." So my question for you is, do we have a LinkedIn group or something that we can all stay connected or anything like that?
Fantastic idea.
Yeah.
We'll do that. We'll do that.
I actually have a couple of questions, if that's okay. Okay. So my first one is, how does one make her leadership skills known in a fast-paced, competitive, male-dominated environment?
Always one picking up. How come all of them are right here in front of me? Yeah, okay, that one's working. That's a good question. No, that's difficult. And some of that's gonna be relationship because you have to have someone who's your advocate, I think. And if you're building those relationships and not just across with your peers and colleagues, but you know, in senior leadership and so forth and in different functions and partners, your accomplishments will speak for themselves. But you do have to have an advocate who's going to take your accomplishments. It's a little hard to speak highly of yourself and say, "Hey, look what I did," because then that doesn't go over well. But if you have someone who's doing that for you, and again, it's all about that relationship building, is one way I would say that would be have some success.
Can I just add? Just yell it. Yeah. Sorry, I won't yell. Sorry. I think you have to be able to deliver your message succinctly. So practice how you articulate it, and I think also, sometimes it's about what's the product that you're advertising, right? So if you're trying to get assistance, if you're trying to get money, what are you putting in front of your people to communicate what your ask is? I think we have to be good about preparing professional presentations. We have to practice how we deliver them, and I think that will speak volumes too. So I think in addition to relationships, you have to be able to really assert your ideas in an effective manner. So communication, products, things like that. And then also, if you can build consensus, if people are talking about you within the company through your network, through your relationships, like Tammy was saying, is a good thing. Because you want to be that person that's all of a sudden kind of like thrown everybody a little off, and that's going to cause you to rise to the level.
Be the go-to.
Yeah, be the go-to. That's just what you said just made me think of one thing. If you can measure it, and if it's a metric that you can show actual progress, which is really hard in this industry, frankly, but if you can find it and you can measure it and you can show those results, that's
that's tangible. That's something that people understand, and they and show some success. Just speak, it speaks for itself. So that would be another way, if it's possible, with whatever it is that you've accomplished.
I was just going to add one other thing. I think the other thing is, don't assume that they know everything you know. So when you're pulling the information together, set a level, set the level, ground everybody, because very often, I know I'm guilty of this, you know, I assume people understand where I'm coming from and what the starting point is. Always ground the starting point so that everybody understands where you're coming from, because then I think you're building from a common base and people understand what you've achieved.
Thank you. And my next question was, what advice would you give to someone in an admin position who wants to work their way up in the security world?
You know what the answer is?
Mentor.
You can, here.
No.
Yeah, it is about mentorship, and it's also about, you know, raising your hand to do something different and stretching yourself and do, just try and learn as much as you can about the position you want to go into. But it really is all the things that I talked about regarding, you know, training and reading about stuff and talking to people who are in that position, not even just in your company, but in other companies as well. But that's another point where if you want to move up, you got to find some people to come along with you and help you get there. And that's, again, the whole power of relationships and mentoring. So, but I would just say be really open to just learning as much as you can and just soaking it all in.
And I would just add, sometimes it's helpful, and this is regardless of what position you're in, it's just, if you're the person that says yes when everybody else says no, it will separate you, right? So there will be a million people in your career that will say, never volunteer for anything. I had millions of people tell me that, right? But the way that set me apart is when I said yes when everybody else said no. And so regardless of what position you're in, if you take those opportunities, even if they're hard, difficult, you know, maybe even a little risky, people will recognize you as someone who's willing to put themselves out there. And so that will separate you from the rest of everybody else.
I'll say, too, take ownership of your development plan. So have a strategy and take ownership of how you want to develop and make that known. So I'll tell you, at HPE, our CSO's admin wanted exactly what you just described. And I'll tell you, she made it known. They developed her plan and her training and you know, where she needed to go and what she needed to learn in that direction. He was supportive of it, so that was a hugely big piece of that. But she is no longer an admin. She's in the security realm, and she's still continuing on with other things that she's interested in besides what she's doing now as a security a specialist. So then she's moving on. She'd like to do investigations and so forth. And she's been successful as she's gone along. So just make it known and own it.
So I was just going to say, my first job out of college was as an admin. So I started, you know, learning about business. I did a business degree, but went back into working for a variety of different businesses, actually, in my first few years of my career as an admin. But I made sure that I learned everything I needed to know. I also, to your point, I asked for additional duties. I got additional duties. And, you know, I sought out the people that could help me. And I do think that that's a, you know, and particularly in the US, it is the land of opportunity. That opportunity still exists. And there are really no barriers if you choose to make those decisions yourself and take ownership of your own career. So it can definitely be done. There's many of us that have done that. So good luck.
First of all, thank you so much for speaking to us. I think it's motivating and inspiring to hear all your stories and your journeys. My question is, what conferences and books would you recommend? And maybe that's part of the LinkedIn chat that we all have.
I think ATAP is good. If y'all know ATAP, right? We should. Association of Threat Assessment Professionals. And they have their annual conference at Disneyland. So every August at Disneyland Resort. It's kind of a no-brainer. ASIS, of course.
Who, what?
HTCIA, a lot of acronyms, of course. Conferences, yeah. So ATAP has their conference. I can't. You got me, Rachel. Let me think about it, and I'm sure we can all put our heads together and put it on LinkedIn, our LinkedIn group, our new LinkedIn group.
I have a couple of suggestions. How to Win Friends and Influence People by Dale Carnegie is a really wonderful book. It's been around for a long time, and he's really the author, I think, who took that forefront on in terms of turning just the literary side into really helpful business advice, and that book has flourished. I'm also a big fan of Malcolm Gladwell. He wrote Blink, as well as David and Goliath, is one of his more recent novels. And essentially it discusses, the struggle that we all know about between David and Goliath and how David overcomes. And it's really interesting because there are a lot of allegories and parallels to what we do today in corporate America, as well as even in our personal lives and sort of how we can address those things. So,
I have one more thing. It's really off topic, but the book is Life is Good by John and Bert Jacobs. They developed the Life is Good t-shirt brand, you know, all that. I just saw him at a keynote. At the Watermark Conference for Women, Silicon Valley. So that's another conference to go to. It was just last week. So the Watermark Conference is in San Jose. Anyway, Life is Good. That book is so awesome, and it's so on such basic levels, but it has optimism throughout it. It has giving back. It has humor. It has fun, and it's just it's been such a nice refresher for me to step back from all this work stuff and read something that is really good for my soul. And I think that's a good thing. We all need that. So Life is Good.
I was just going to say the book I referred to, The Loudest Duck, when you're looking, and so it's by a lady called Laura Liswood.
So there's a good reading list for everybody when they leave. Just wanted to say that lunch is ready to go and started about 10 minutes ago technically. We've got beverages and some dessert set up on this side. In the hallway, you can just make a loop around and you can grab a plate, and it's just going to be buffet style. Grab what you need. Come back in. Sit down. We're going to do some raffle prizes, which if you take a look over there, I don't think we did too bad. So, so definitely stick around for that. And if anybody else has any more questions, feel free to come up and ask any of the individual speakers, and we'd be happy to address your question. So thanks.